I'm standing outside the quadrangle here at Sydney University, and let's just go for a little wander through Sydney University. There's something I want to show you that I think is interesting. Up here we see a shield, and on the shield we see the harp, which is perhaps a depiction or an explanation, if you will, regarding sound, whilst the lions are representing light. And we'll just keep on wandering through. So as per the Bible, where the sun, where God is perhaps a sun and a shield, the shield perhaps represents the shield of magnetism that protects the earth and protects life on earth. And of course the sun is depicted on here as well, that hits or that hits the shield and protects the earth. We can see a nice pineal gland up there. So we'll carry on over this way to the Faculty of Education, and you can see the checkers and the red fire triangle too on the Faculty of Education here at Sydney University. So this is the Faculty of Education at Sydney University, and as you can see, it was put up in 1993, not that long ago. And we're on the other side of it now, and this is the little forecourt here with the nine squares that are perhaps relate to Saturn, the Saturnian magic square, if you will. So I wonder who put this building together. The two outer towers are quite representative of the pillars. And now we're just going to go across this way to the School of Physics. So we'll go over and have a look at the School of Physics here at Sydney University, and then we will go and visit Gilgamesh over here. There is a statue of Gilgamesh. Here is a kookaburra enjoying the game of football outside the School of Physics. On the School of Physics here, we have a nice depiction of the sun on a shield. So out in front of the School of Physics here, we possibly have the three steps going from the base of the Masonic floor, if you will, up onto the sort of Grand Master's chair. And then this circle area outside the front of the School of Physics here is perhaps a representation of one of the orbs. And you have the sort of light sort of emanating out, if you will, from that section. And then if we look up at the entranceway, we have the pillars of Jachin and Boaz coming down, male and female, positive and negative, if you will, with the area of equilibrium perhaps in the middle there, with the sun window, or the spiritual sun perhaps, depicted above here. Above that is the shield, representing perhaps both the shield of magnetism and the lion, representing electricity. That's just my theory. So we'll walk inside the foyer here and have a look inside. start out with. We have numerous instruments for measuring the cosmos and so forth. We have a tuning instrument here, an instrument for tuning. Think about those two pillars out there. And perhaps if one walks between the pillars, one perhaps gets tuned. So there's some measurements there of amplitude by the look of it. Some further bits and pieces here. So forth and so forth. Things to measure the cosmos and so forth. Now, up above the door here is a cartouche, and I saw a picture today of an angel type figure holding a cartouche. So that cartouche perhaps in part represents protection from electrical force perhaps, or it creates an equilibrium. Now, right above here is something I came here to show people. Now these parts here, they're name tags, and we'll get that over and done with. There's Einstein, so people who have contributed to physics in the past, the great masters. And in the corners of this room, we have these shields. So let's start out by looking at the shield up here with a depiction of the sun on it. And I'll try to hold the camera steady, but there is the sun. And so the sun is perhaps an electrical body, if you will. And then if we go directly opposite the sun, diagonally across, we go to this way, and we have the electrical force, a clear depiction of the electrical force in diagonal. In a diagonal line here, almost facing the sun, if you will, because these shields sort of face diagonally into this room here, which is slightly, it's a rectangular shape, excuse me. So up here we have the waters, voluminous waters here, a clear depiction of the seas, or a vast body of water. So perhaps just like we had the sun, a vast body of electricity, we have the water here, perhaps representing a vast body of magnetism. We also get Mary, Mater, material. Water is material, you can pick it up with your hands. Whereas the sun, Pater, pattern, creates the pattern. So now, if we go opposite the water, just as we had the micro, we had the sun with the micro lightning strikes, if you will, or electricity. Here we have the water droplets. And we have, you can see the redness on them. So these are perhaps droplets created from heat, from heating the water in this case. So what we have in this room are perhaps diagonals with the electrical sun here going in a diagonal line across to the electricity up here. And then likewise we have the water, the vast waters here, and then a diagonal line across we have the droplets of water here, the water in another state or a more refined state, if you will. So, right in the middle of all this is a light, a hexagonal light. So within that hexagon, we can perhaps get the two triangles of male and female, if you will, that Star of David, if you will. And within this light, we have both light coming out of it, plus the structure of the light is matter. Mater, that's the water part, if you will. That is the matter plus the pattern, the light pattern. So, and of course, the hexagonal shape gives us those two triangles. The one facing down would be the female, the blue one, and then the red one would be the one sort of facing up, the fire triangle. So I just thought I'd show that. Also, up here, we have various depictions. Now, some of these I'm not quite sure what they are, but we have the phoenix here rising with this, what is perhaps an instrument. I'm not quite sure what that symbolism is. And we have some further symbolism up here as well. The red and the blue are perhaps, once again, depicting electricity and magnetism. And across this side, we have it there, a magnet, right up there as well, in the images that we find up here. Across from the magnet, we have the light, electricity. So the magnet looks across to that light bulb there. And up here, we have another instrument as well, of some sort. I'm not quite sure what that is. And then, interestingly, right up here, we have the flame amid two fish there. That is perhaps the flame that sort of releases the spirit, if you will, and one from the world of materialism, and perhaps matter for that. Material and matter, and perhaps pattern. So, thought I'd just show people this. So, I hope you've found it interesting. And yeah.
All right. Okay, so from the Faculty of Physics, let's go over in this direction over here to the statue of Gilgamesh.
So here we have Gilgamesh, and I'll just point out that over here we have the Sydney Uni Sport and Fitness Centre with the lion on the shield. The lion, of course, representing the sun and the energy from the sun. So it's very fitting to have it as part of the sport and fitness centre here at Sydney Uni. Anyway, so here is Gilgamesh in statue form here at Sydney Uni, and this tale comes from Mesopotamia, perhaps it's said from the 18th century BC, and the tale of Gilgamesh depicts Gilgamesh here and his friendship with Enkidu. Now there is also a flood in that tale, and a garden of Eden also. There are some likenesses between the Epic of Gilgamesh and the Bible.
So for simplicity's sake, I'll just read straight from Wikipedia regarding the relationship to the Bible of the Epic of Gilgamesh. So here we go. Various themes, plot elements, and characters in the Epic of Gilgamesh have been found in the Bible, notably in the stories of the Garden of Eden and Noah's Flood. The parallels between the stories of Enkidu / Shamhat and Adam / Eve have been long recognized by scholars. In both, a man is created from the earth by a creator god, and lives in a natural setting amongst the animals. He is introduced to a woman who tempts him. In both stories, the man accepts food from the woman, covers his nakedness, and must leave his former realm, unable to return. The presence of a snake that steals a plant of immortality from the hero later in the epic is another point of contact. Andrew R. George submits that the flood story in Genesis 8-6 matches the Gilgamesh flood myth so closely, few doubt that it derives from the Mesopotamian account. What is particularly noticeable is that is the way the Genesis flood story follows the Gilgamesh flood tale, point by point in the same order, even when the story permits other alternatives.
The School of Physics is just down here, and the statue of Gilgamesh is in the centre of this shot here. And to finish out, I'm on, or just beside this chessboard right here. The quadrangle is just up here. This is the McLaurin wing of the McLaurin Hall on the south wing of the quadrangle. And I'll just finish up by just simply saying that I hope you've enjoyed the video, and bye for now.